Test 1, 2, 3. Test 1, 2. Hello, Rod. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Aren't we lucky? Aren't we lucky? Thank you, Ruth. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see you on a nice sunny Sunday. Here we are after Easter, but still kind of with Easter, and looking forward to a wonderful, wonderful spring. A big welcome to all of you this morning and our visitors this morning. Good to see you, and also a big hearty welcome to those watching us and listening on Facebook and Zoom this morning. Yeah, very good to see you. First, do we have any announcements this morning? Anything that people would like to share? Jan. Okay, Steve.
Following the service this morning, I'd like to have a worship team meeting. So, either do that worship team or anybody who wants to join in to talk about our worship services, then hopefully it'll be short. But they might have the service today.
Okay, worship. Okay, worship team members, please take note, and anybody. Lou. All right, take note, rummage sale, May 6th, 7th, and 8th. And for those of you peeking into our service from the outside world this morning, mark your calendars, May 6th, 7th, and 8th, garage sale here at First Congregational Church, with all proceeds going to the congregators, our wonderful women's group, correct?
Sunday before, make sure you're here.
Yes, that's when the heavy lifting comes forward, right, Lou? Doris. So, Doris, what you're saying is you're encouraging us to start bringing stuff?
Oh, yeah. Well, we've already started bringing stuff.
Okay.
Neatly.
Neatly. That's the key word. Okay. All right, so. Okay.
Is there a sign up sheet for assistance?
Not yet.
Okay,
not yet.
All right. Do your. All right, so May 6th and 7th for the public.
Okay.
Yeah, Glenn.
On the 23rd of April, we'll have free vaccinations for anybody that needs those, from 16 on up, I believe it is, maybe even 15 on up, and no charge, no appointment is needed, and luck to everybody that needs a shot on the 23rd of April.
Okay, so,
10 to 2.
Okay, 10 to 2, okay, take note, everybody. For all here and for those listening in, a COVID-19 shot opportunity April 23rd from 10 to noon at the Imlay City Senior Center for ages 16 on up. So please take note. Okay? Well, if there are no further announcements, let us pause for a moment of reflection and contemplation to prepare ourselves for worship. Thank you. And now let us continue in prayer. God, though our questions may overwhelm us and our doubts stridently speak, we praise you, O God, still for the gift of faith. Though we may miss the signs of your life and ignore the little resurrections all around us, we praise you, Divine Spirit, for the gift of faith. Though we may constantly seek after proof, and refuse sometimes to believe without seeing, we praise you, O Christ, for the gift of faith. We thank you, God, for your life that transcends our understanding, for your presence from which we can never flee, for your resurrection which is never defeated, and for the gift of faith that enables us to trust even in the midst of our doubts and fears. Amen. Now, would you please stand or stand in spirit as we begin our worship, as we always do with our call to worship. Direct your attention to the words on the screen. Sing to the Lord a new song as we begin our worship today, my friends, for God has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. And we say together, we give thanks to you, Lord, for you have done marvelous things. When we were walking in darkness, you were there. You were there. When we were kneeling in weakness, you were there. You were there. When we drew near, feeling worthless, you were there. You were there. When we were needing forgiveness, you were there. You were there. When we were searching for your grace, you were there. You were there. We give thanks to you, Lord, for you have done marvelous things. And now, would you please join me as we sing our opening hymn? It is number 257, Alleluia, Gracious Jesus.
Jesus, yours the scepter, yours the throne. Alleluia, yours the triumph, yours the victory alone. Hark the songs of peaceful Zion, thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus, out of every nation, you redeemed us by your blood. Thank you.
angels. You on earth, our food, our stay. Alleluia, hear the faithful flee to you from day to day. Intercessor, friend of sinners, earth's redeemer, plead for me. Eternal, nothing can disrupt your reign. Alleluia, born of Mary, heaven and earth are your domain. Human life you fully enter, tending those who count the least, serving both the good, friends, let us now pause as we continue on in our worship service by confessing our sins. Wondrous God, we confess that at times our doubts and fears override our hope and faith. Forgive us when we lose sight of the joy of your love and instead fall into despair and gloom. Lift up our spirits, Lord, and help us remember the promise of a new life here, now, and not just the hope of resurrection for the future. We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who offers us new life, who continues to break down the walls of death in our own life. Forgive us, restore us, and renew us. In the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Friends, the tomb is empty. The stone is rolled away. There is no darkness now, only light. God continues to renew us and restore us. We are forgiven, loved, and restored, receiving the gift of promise of new life and resurrection now. Go and share the wondrous news of God's love in Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning is the walk to Emmaus. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you're walking along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and they told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb, and we found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near to the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread. He blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread.
Thank you, Jan. As someone who has worked for many years in corporate America prior to coming here, I've had my fair share, probably like you, of supervisors, the big bosses, or the one boss. And so you'll understand, at least in my case, why I enjoy the TV show that's called, and maybe you're familiar with it, Undercover Boss. You heard of it? For those of you that perhaps have been not turning on the TV on a regular basis, it's a show in which high-level executives slip anonymously into the rank and file of their business. They put on disguises, everything from new hair to clothes and everything. And they go in and they examine the inner working, the guts of their businesses. They interact with their employees. In some cases, they come across as very naive and needing a little tutelage of how the business that they're so familiar with works. They find out a lot. And then at the very end of the show, the boss reveals him or herself and offers up some observations. And in many cases, gives a wonderful gift or gifts to employees, especially the needy ones. Very interesting. When you really think about it, Jesus kind of falls into a similar scenario in our Road to Emmaus account this morning, which has been termed by some as the most dramatic resurrection narrative in the New Testament. Now, this morning, Jesus is not really in disguise, at least not to us. He is there, though, not really being seen. He's not there to evaluate his disciples or followers, nor does he come out, at least right away, and offer tips on how to live or what it means to follow him. But he does offer up, as we learned this morning, some practical advice, and eventually is no longer disguised, no longer hidden. Our setting in Luke this morning is not the office, but it's a dusty road that leads to the small village of Emmaus, which is about just under 8 miles west of Jerusalem. It's Easter Sunday evening. Of course, last Sunday we were at Easter, but it is still Easter, and now it is night. Two of his followers are on that road to Emmaus, coming from Jerusalem, and they're having a very animated conversation. They're dejected at the same time. They're down. They're distraught, and they're wondering what's coming next. For Jesus has been killed, and his tomb has been found empty. Suddenly, Jesus walks up behind them and joins in their conversation. The followers of Jesus, these two, they didn't recognize this stranger in their midst. Perhaps God, in this case, might have been using the setting sun in the west to make the two squint a little bit and therefore unable to see Christ's presence among them. Interestingly enough, if we recall in Numbers, and long before this journey, it was said that the children of Israel journeyed into the wilderness toward a rising sun on their way to the promised land. Interesting. You wonder where Luke gets his material from sometimes, huh? Christians, noted one scholar, always go onwards, if we keep in mind that passage from Numbers. They always go onward, not to a night that never falls, but to a dawn which breaks. And that is what we see this morning. Two followers heading in the west, seeing a sunrise, and yet before them was a new dawn, walking with them, a new light, a new resurrection in Jesus Christ. Now, to be fair to our two followers of Jesus on the road to Emmaus, people failing to recognize the holy in their midst was not a new thing. If you remember, Moses did not initially recognize it was none other than God that was talking through the burning bush. Or how about the time when God visited Abraham in the form of three travelers? Abraham did not recognize those three travelers. Perhaps it was the intense conversation our two travelers were having with this stranger that blinded them to whom they were really talking to, sun aside. And oh, what a conversation it was, as we heard this morning. Luke gives us a very interesting account of this conversation for a couple of reasons. For starters, Luke brilliantly uses, and maybe you recognize this as well, Luke brilliantly uses Jesus to set up that conversation on the road to Emmaus with questions. What are you discussing? What things? What things? All, of course, in regards to the passion narrative that we know so well. Then Luke masterfully has the two travelers recount for us and Jesus the events leading up to that time and where they found themselves on that road to Emmaus that night. You can hear the pain and the shock of the two men as they retell to Jesus an account of what happened in Jerusalem, and basically saying the same account that Christ himself had told many, many times to the apostles before his arrest and death on the cross. Nothing had changed in society, our two followers to Jesus knew. The brutal iron hand of Rome was still in control. Oppression was still taking place in society. And no king had come to set the people free. You can also almost hear the disappointment and sadness in the voices of the two followers of Jesus. Sadness over the hope that Jesus was supposed to be the one that would redeem Israel, and that by his suffering and death on the cross would have brought salvation to sinners, the present sinners, us. This conversation by our two followers of Jesus gives Luke another remarkable opening now for Jesus to insert himself into the conversation and clearly say something that he really hadn't said succinctly and out loud. He was the Messiah. He was the Messiah. And Jesus is also given another opportunity to testify that he really is a prophet. He came from a long line of prophets, as we know. Prophets who were called by God to call out a sinful people and offer them redemption. And in that one Emmaus road journey with his two followers, Jesus succinctly reveals the meaning of the resurrection hours after it took place on that Easter night. Christ's death was a victory over death. And he revealed his mission. Christ's suffering resulted in death, but then resurrection, and now repentance and forgiveness of sins for all. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be preached to all nations by all disciples, and of course us. Jesus does something else that's evocative. Close to Emmaus, he knows a dinner invitation is coming from these two followers, but he didn't want to invite himself, did he? So he walks ahead out of essentially the social practice of that time, social deference. You don't invite yourself to dinner. So he walks ahead. In Near Eastern customs, a guest was obligated to turn down such an invitation until it was vigorously repeated by the invitees. So that's what Jesus does. And of course, what happens at the meal that Easter night is even more evocative. More evocative than that road to Emmaus conversation. As Jesus begins to eat with his two followers, we can remember the words from Revelation. Listen, listen, I am standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with you, and you with me. Jesus breaks bread, as we know, with his hosts, blesses it, repeating those familiar words that we know from the Eucharist. His disciples, of course, knowing so well, too. That meal that Jesus had and blessed before revealing who he was and then disappearing all of a sudden was more than just reenacting the Eucharist. It's much bigger than that. That meal and the conversation that he had on the road with his followers are two of the many powerful experiences, rather powerful examples of Jesus in our midst and the meaning of Easter being with us 24/7, 365. Because of Jesus, meals are now symbols of hospitality and a place where God gathers with us. Jesus showed that meals are a place for us and the people around us, whether we know the strangers in our midst. And those meals are there to experience the holy presence of God. And any other meal that we have is another opportunity to realize Christ, the sacred, the holy in our midst. And not only at church and at the altar, but in a very simple meal. And at the same time, those meals give us camaraderie and the hospitality of God. Offering a meal is hospitality, which of course Christ showed so many times. God wants us to extend radical hospitality to others. We know this. A meal, think about this, while simple and unpretentious, is a grand tribute to the presence of God. It's a meal that shows the love of God to others around us at the table. Emmaus Road and Easter also shows us God's presence can come suddenly, unexpectedly, and not on our schedule, and can leave us awestruck afterwards. As we know, Jesus just vanished from that meal with his two followers just as soon as he was recognized. This shows that God's presence is always elusive, fleeting, and dancing on the edge of our awareness and perception. You might remember The Sound of Music. I'm sure everybody's familiar with that wonderful movie. And during the movie, if you remember, the nuns were singing a certain tune. I'm not going to try to sing it. How can you catch a moonbeam in your hand? How do you hold a wave upon the sand? God can be present in the moonlight, bouncing off water, in a sunrise or a sunset, in a song that gives you goosebumps, or in an unexpected kind word that you get from a stranger. Easter and the Emmaus Road shows us that God is present if we only open our eyes. Have you noticed that during the pandemic that we're in right now, people are wearing masks, and it takes a little longer to recognize people, doesn't it? Even people we know. You're now wondering, who is that person behind the mask? But what it does do is it focuses our attention on people's eyes, which I think sometimes we miss. Because think about it, we don't always look people square in the eye, especially strangers. So it's hard to recognize people. God and Jesus Christ are in our midst each and every day we live. Are our eyes wide open? Christ showed in the Emmaus Road conversation and in that meal how we can become blind to sensing, seeing, smelling, and touching God around us. And just as important, recognizing people in our midst that need our help and our attention. For we see the face of Jesus in every person we meet. Do we sometimes fail to help the beggar in the street? Do we fail to speak out sometimes against actions and policies that we know can hurt the least among us? God and Jesus Christ, plus many who have never set foot inside this church or other congregations, are looking to us to make a difference, to stand out, to stand up, and to be counted, and stick out in a good way in addressing the poor and the needy among us in our community and across the globe. We must be open and receptive to taking in the holy in our midst, the face of Jesus that we see in other people, and realizing when it is present and seeking our help. We must, as we use the words from Luke, be attentive to when our hearts are burning within us, pointing the way that the sacred is in our midst and is looking for our help. I recall these words when we think about being open to the holy in our midst. The words, "Open my eyes that I may see," that was penned by Clara Scott. The first verse of that hymn goes like this. "Open my eyes that I may see, glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illuminate me, Spirit divine." Easter and the Emmaus Road reminds us that we can get stuck in a rut, too. Perhaps we have a wonderful routine that we're very comfortable with following each day. But here's the thing. God crashes our lives sometimes and asks us to do something we think we have no business or aptitude for. Maybe it's going to seminary. Maybe it's serving on a committee in the community, heading up a homeless shelter, serving on church council, consoling a total stranger who was feeling down and needing help. In Luke today, Jesus eats with us as he does those two followers. He's in our midst right now. He's along for our journey. And he looks for us to change when needed for God's purposes. He is our undercover boss who is not seen but is always present, always around us, and who burns our heart with his presence and is waiting to be discovered by us so we can be used by Christ for God's kingdom. Let us never forget that. Never forget that. And how the resurrection is always playing out in our midst. For we are resurrection people now and in the life to come. Let us pray. Risen Lord, What is it that sometimes keeps us from recognizing you? Sometimes it's too easy to block you right out of our lives. God, perhaps we are guilty sometimes of being slow of heart when we don't recognize you in our neighbor. Risen Lord Jesus, help us to empty ourselves of all that hinders our awareness of your presence with us. Fill us with the joy of knowing your continuing presence, Jesus, so that like those travelers on the road to Emmaus, we too will hasten to share this great good news that you have risen and are with us always. Amen. Since we are on that walk with Jesus, and we always want to be walking with Jesus, would you please sing now this hymn? It is called, I Want Jesus to Walk with Me. One time through, Ruth's going to play it. Jesus, walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me. All along my pilgrim journey, Lord wants us to walk with me. Walk with me. In my trials, Lord, walk with me. When my heart is almost breaking, Lord, I want to walk with me. Walk with me. When I'm in trouble, Lord, walk with me. When my head I'm bowed in sorrow, Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for gathering us this morning and for inviting us along the road to Emmaus and in that room with your two followers. We rejoice that your resurrection has brought us so much. We love you and you thank you for your sacrifices and for bringing the kingdom to us. Lord, in this beautiful sunny Sunday morning, we thank you for the signs of spring in nature with the buds coming out on the trees, the spring flowers, the wonderful smells and sights of your creation breaking forward despite the challenges that we face today. Lord, as we always do this time every Sunday, we thank you for all those that are serving in the military and protecting us, our men and women. We also thank you for the first responders, the hospital cleaners, the doctors, the nurses, and all that care for those who are sick, especially in this time of the pandemic. Lord, we rejoice at the blessings that you give us, but we also remember those that are suffering loss. loss of a job, loss of a loved one. We mourn those that we have lost in our own families and amongst our friends. We mourn and we pray for the family of Teresa. For Teresa has gone to be with you and the saints on high. And Lord, we pause now and say to you, either in silence or out loud, our own prayers and our own petitions to you. Lord, you have heard our prayers and petitions. And now we say to you out loud and together the prayer that the risen one has taught us. We say together, Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I hold up our offering plate this morning as a sign of thanks for our tithes and offerings. I offer up this prayer on our behalf. God of great gifts, this morning we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you thanks. With resurrection humming in our hearts, our minds are tuned to your song of peace. We joyfully present these gifts to you, joyfully. A tangible chorus of thanksgiving, a harmony of hope for your kingdom that has come. Amen. Now, my friends, would you please stand or stand in spirit one more time as we sing our closing hymn number 514, Incarnate God, Immortal Love. Excuse me, 414. God, immortal love, whom we that have not seen your face, by faith and faith alone embrace, believing where we cannot prove, your will not leave us in the dark. You gave us life, we know not why. We trust we were not made to die. For you have made us, you are just. In you meet you. Union, no, we falsely call our own until.
all systems have their day. They have and see and cease to be. They are but fleeting certainty. And you, O Christ, are more than they.
Friends, as we think about this day, as we go forward from this place to know today, know that the risen Christ is always in our midst, looking to crash our routine and looking for us to act on a moment's notice for the ones that need our help. In the name of the resurrected Christ, we pray. Amen.